Everyone likes to joke about the amazing shelf life of Twinkies.
Still fresh.
But the truth is, these guys aren't that special, because a lot of the products you buy at the grocery store have similarly long shelf lives. And that's because science has developed some amazing food preservatives to keep them around for as long as possible. Whether it's keeping your crisps crisp or your pastries soft, decades of food research has given us all kinds of tools to keep our favorite foods tastier for longer. So let's talk about some of the main types of preservatives you might find in your groceries, how they work, and whether you need to keep an eye on how much of them you're eating. Let's start with one of the bigger categories of food preservative that's all about texture. There's a group of substances called anti-staling agents, which put up a fight against dry bread and biscuits you could break a tooth on. And there are a bunch of them that all prevent staleness in different ways. But for this video, we're gonna focus on humectants. The word humectant comes from the Latin word meaning to moisten. And like the name suggests, humectants are in your food to help it keep its moisture. Oddly enough, they're mostly used in dry foods, like shredded coconut, cheese, candy, and cured meats like jerky. See, these foods are dry on the outside, but they do have some moisture on the inside, and if that water escapes, the food can either dry out too much or become a bacterial breeding ground. Humectants bind to the moisture existing in your food and keep it from escaping, which keeps your favorite snack nice and chewy, or soft, or whatever texture you want it to be. Some of the humectants that are used in our packaged foods are so common that you have them in your pantry. The original humectants are plain old sugar and salt, but nowadays there are also more processed ones like high fructose corn syrup and glucose syrup. So the rules for safety with eating humectants are basically the same as they are for stuff like sugar and salt, because that's usually what they are. Enjoy your sweet or salty humectants in moderation. Moving on, let's talk about keeping our foods healthy, not just crunchy. You probably hear a lot of talk about how antioxidants are good for your body, but it turns out that they're good for your food too. Some of the more common synthetic antioxidants out there are butylated hydroxytoluene, also called BHT, and butylated hydroxyanisole, which is also called BHA. While they do help keep foods from going stale, they have a bigger purpose than just preventing moisture loss. Antioxidants work against oxidants. A shocking revelation, I know. But a slightly better way to say this is that they help prevent the chemical reaction called oxidation. Oxidation is just what happens when a thing reacts with oxygen, and it happens to a lot of stuff. It's why iron gets rusty, and why the copper on the Statue of Liberty turned green. And yep, this can happen to our food as well. When the food touches air, the fats react with oxygen to produce what are known as free radicals, which are little thief molecules that go around stealing electrons from other molecules. This reaction degrades those fats and can turn them rancid. And when we eat foods that have gone rancid, it's not just the flavor that gets messed up. Free radicals in rancid food can cause inflammation and damage in certain tissues in our bodies when they nab electrons from our molecules. But thankfully, we have antioxidants to protect us from these radical invaders. BHA and BHT catch free radicals and neutralize them, meaning they can no longer steal electrons from anybody else. So antioxidants are our main line of defense against free radicals. And not only are they totally safe to eat, a lot of them are really good for us. Antioxidants occur naturally in fruits and vegetables. For instance, tomatoes are chock full of an antioxidant called lycopene, which also has some potent health benefits, like lowering the risk of certain cancers. But the antioxidants that we cook up in labs, like BHA and BHT, seem to be a little more controversial than their naturally occurring cousins. Several big organizations, including the International Agency for Research on Cancer and the European Commission on Endocrine Disruption, have listed these substances as potential carcinogens, or at least substances to watch. Mice and hamsters that were fed diets containing BHA in it developed tumors in their stomachs, and mangrove rivulus fish that consumed BHA developed liver cancer, which sounds scary at first. But those rodents were getting mega doses of BHA. The maximum amount of BHA that manufacturers are allowed to add is 0.005% of the food content in a single product. Meanwhile, the rodents were being fed as much as 1-2% every day for up to 2 years, and the fish were getting similarly massive doses too. It's also worth mentioning that you, watching this video, are neither a mangrove rivulus fish nor a rodent. probably. Unless you are, in which case, thanks for watching. Just because BHA and BHT are toxic to rodents and fish at huge doses doesn't automatically mean they're toxic to you. Not a single study on these substances has found any direct link between BHA or BHT and cancer in humans. So not only do we not think these things are necessarily all that dangerous, you'd have to really work hard to ingest enough to get you into the danger zone. As long as you're not literally chugging vegetable oils, you're probably in the clear. While plenty of us like the occasional mushroom topping on a pizza or a sprinkle of blue cheese on our salads, there are a lot of molds and fungi that are very bad for us to eat. Thankfully, we have these things called antifungals to stop the molds that we don't like from growing in our food. Some common ones you might find on an ingredient list are benzoate or benzoic acid, sorbate or sorbic acid, nitrates and nitrites, and sulfites. And these things are super important because keeping your food from getting moldy is harder than it seems. Mold spreads to your piece of bread or cheese via microscopic spores that could come from an already infected food source or even just from the air. Once these food spores land on something they want to call home, they produce long root threads that penetrate the food item, then grow stalks with even more spores on them. Those stalks and spores are the fuzzy bits you might find on the strawberries that have been in the back of your fridge for too long, or that blue lump hiding in your bag of four cheese Mexican blend. These bad molds can give you allergies, and some even release toxins which can make you super sick if you eat them. And those of you who just cut off the moldy bit or take out the moldy fruit from the package, you know, I see you. But unfortunately, although it might look like the rest of your bread or cheese is perfectly fine, that fuzz means those little fungal roots have gotten all the way into that piece of food. This is where antifungals come in. Some fungi, like yeasts, have a lot of trouble growing in places that are super acidic. So when antifungals like benzoic or sorbic acid get added to your food, they lower the pH and slow the mold's growth, keeping your food mold-free for longer. And a lot of them, like benzoic and sorbic acids, have no known side effects, except in the rare case that you're allergic to it. Nitrates and nitrites are a bit more complicated, but we'll talk about those later. But there's no reason to fear these additives that keep the fun in your food by keeping the fun guy out. Unfortunately, mold isn't the only unwelcome guest that can grow in our snacks. There's also bacteria, which we can help prevent using good old-fashioned antibiotics. People first started using antibiotics as food preservatives in the 1940s and 50s. The ones they ended up focusing on were the tetracyclines, which are also used in medication. Tetracyclines kill bacteria by going after their protein factory, the ribosome. They attach there and prevent the bacteria from making the proteins that it needs to function, so the bacteria dies. This prevents bacteria from growing inside packaged food and extends the shelf life of the food item. However, there's been a push to move away from using antibiotics in packaged foods because of the whole antibiotic resistance thing. The more often a bacteria population encounters an antibiotic, the more likely it is that the bacteria will mutate and become resistant to it. Antibiotic-resistant bacteria are one of the World Health Organization's top threats to global health, and were responsible for more than 1 million deaths in 2019. So to try and avoid making more superbugs, scientists have suggested using substances called bacteriocins instead of antibiotics. These bacteria-fighting molecules are actually derived from bacteria itself. Bacteria generally don't like to compete for resources with other bacteria strains, so they'll release bacteriocins to try to kill their competitors. And scientists can use these bacteriocins to ward off dangerous pathogens in food, making sure you don't get sick. While we have good evidence that bacteriocins aren't going to do any harm to our human cells, they might not be quite so gentle on the little guys we have living in our guts. See, bacteriocins can't discriminate between good and bad bacteria, so bacteriocins, like antibiotics, have the potential to affect our gut microbiome. Still, researchers agree that having some way to prevent bacterial contamination in our food is kind of important. So the next steps are to start looking for even better ways to keep our food bacteria-free. But for now, bacteriocins are some of the best tools we have. This last one isn't actually about keeping your food fresh, but rather keeps your food looking like it's fresh. Some food producers will add colorants to deli meat in order to give it a nice pink color. Now, to be clear, this isn't a way of disguising expired food as still fresh. It's more about making sure that your deli meat looks as fresh as it actually is. Without colorants, your deli meats would look brown pretty much immediately when they hit the air. If your lunch meat looks brown instead of pink, you might think it's it's bad and throw it out, which is a waste. So colorants help stop the pinkish hue from fading too soon, making your ham sandwich all the more appetizing. And this is where those nitrates and nitrites come back in, because they're some of the oldest and most common colorants we use. Like, we've been using them since 3000 BC. They react with myoglobin and metmyoglobin, which are iron-containing proteins in muscles, to maintain that pink color. And because they're also antioxidants, they really do keep your food fresh for longer as well. Nitrates and nitrites are found naturally in some vegetables, and can even have some health benefits if consumed in moderation, like reducing blood pressure. However, there is evidence that overdoing it can be not great. Some of the nitrates and nitrites in cured meats can produce what are known as nitrosamines, which have been linked to several different types of cancer. To be at risk for that, though, you need to have eaten a lot of processed meat. The safe amount suggested by the World Health Organization is 3.7 milligrams of nitrate per kilogram of body weight, and between 0.06 and 0.07 milligrams of nitrite per kilogram of body weight. For the average 60-kilogram adult, that's about 24 hot dogs worth. And there's plenty of evidence that the majority of people are eating way less than that. Like, I don't think I've ever eaten 24 hot dogs. Some studies also show that vitamin C can stop nitrosamines from forming, so a lot of cured meat producers now add vitamin C into the mix. So there's no need to worry about what's in your salami sandwich. So whether they're stopping mold or holding in moisture, those hard-to-pronounce preservatives are pretty great at making sure your food stays safe and tasty for as long as possible. As with just about everything at the grocery store, you can have too much of a good thing, but these food preservations tricks mean that we can savor every snack for that much longer. So go ahead, enjoy the fruits of these scientists' labors. I know I will.